3, 2, 1.
Hi everyone, and welcome to the Sea Brigade.
Hello.
My name's Ken. I'll be your host. My co-host is Emily.
As always.
And today we're covering Season 2, Episode 6 of Fargo.
Yay.
Rhinoceros.
Yay.
So, in an episode, or let's say in a season where, for the most part, we can look at the episode names and maybe with just a little bit of research figure out why they went with that episode name. Do you have any idea why they went with rhinoceros for this episode?
I do, and it's only because I did a little research myself, and this is what people seem to have agreed upon. Because it's the name of a Eugene Ionesco play, and it's basically the... Because Ionesco was... he wrote plays in the post-World War II era, and he... They were all kind of these absurdist plays. Like, I saw one... Actually, I saw one performed. It was called The Bald Soprano, and it was just, I don't know, like, it was, like, the set was, like, the sky was on the floor, and the top, like, the furniture was all on the ceiling. It was really strange. And apparently Rhinoceros is about a guy who's a drunk, and he wakes up, and everyone in the town just becomes rhinoceroses. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
Wait, am I missing... Is it just because he's a post-World War II author and, like, this is that time frame?
Yeah, the Theater of the Absurd kind of came to be in that 1950s time period. Apparently, actually, Camus used the term in The Myth of Sisyphus.
Okay.
Which, yeah.
And that's important.
Yeah.
Because that's kind of been the myth... of Sisyphus mm-hmm. came back to haunt us
yes.
for another episode.
Well, and I think too, as we'll talk about, I think Lou and Betsy too, they're both kind of on this idea of how just absurd everything is that's happening to them. Uh-huh. That also goes along with then Jabberwocky, the poem.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, I want to get to that in a chronological
yes.
order, kind of. So this episode wastes no time in picking up where we left off. With the arrest of Ed Blomquist, we see Lou takes Ed away, and Hank stays with Peggy, which leads us to really to our very interesting pairing this episode. Not yes. that we haven't seen Lou and Ed before. We've seen them a lot, actually. Mm-hmm. But as I've written down in my notes, Lou is not taking your shit. And
no.
as you wrote me, the Larsons and Silversons are so done with the Blomquists.
This I know. Episode. They are so over the Blomquists.
Mm-hmm. But I, yeah, you know what? I'll save some comments for later. Like, we have some listener mail.
Yay!
I'm just so eager to get into this episode.
Me too.
It's a very good one.
Yeah. Well, last night I was watching it and mm-hmm. I was. Like, you know how that's apparently that thing where, like, you know, double texting is, like, a faux pas? I probably about 50 texted you before, like, any response. But I was just, like, I was just, like, oh, my God, oh, my God. You know, everything this, everything that. It was, I could not wait to do this episode.
Yes, it was really exciting. So I wrote down some quotes here because... when Lou shows up to the police station in Laverne,
mm-hmm.
I didn't expect Betsy to be there, but I'm so glad she was because it led to really good dialogue.
Yeah.
Because, you know, Lou shows up and he's like, oh, what are you doing here? And, you know, she's like, you know, I'm worried. One of the things she says was, it feels like the top of the world might just spin off a globe these days.
Yeah, I like that
it.
A lot.
Yeah, there was that. Then... you know, Lou was talking about, oh, I'm just imagining you being in Vietnam, you know, in the black pajamas to, you know, leave your husband alone. And then Betsy says, could have saved a lot of lives if wives from both sides came and dragged their fool men home by the ear.
I just love Betsy and Lou. I just love them so much.
I feel like Betsy is even, like, if Betsy and Floyd weren't on moral opposites, they have some similar...
Like, yes.
Values, right?
Yeah.
And what else? Oh, and Noreen is there, and she's just so, like, shaken up. about what happened.
I believe I sent you a text in all caps saying they're adopting Noreen. The potential for Molly Noreen interaction is there.
Yeah. So Lou asks Betsy to take Noreen to their home because Noreen did live above the butcher shop and that's all burned down.
Mm-hmm.
And he says, we know she's just a kid, emancipated or not. So yeah, I he must have some idea that she's like this
nut.
This nut or nihilistic studier of Camus. I do wonder if what happened is going to change her output.
Yeah,
you know?
I don't know.
Because that would be interesting. I believe it's soon after this that we switch to the Gerhardt compound.
Yes.
Because they give Charlie his first phone call, or his only phone call.
Yes.
We don't see it, but what we get is Bear is taken away from his conversation with his father.
Mm-hmm.
And Bear is talking to Otto about, I believe it was...
they were talking about the older brother.
Elrond?
Elrond, yes.
And which made it really interesting. Like, this shed a lot of light for me in the way of where Bear feels he is in the family, because he was the only one home when the soldiers came back to say that, you know, he had died. I guess Otto was gone. Maybe even... made it sound like Bear was basically the only one there. And part of why he probably doesn't see... or absolutely why he doesn't see Dodd as the successor is that Dodd isn't the oldest son.
He's
the oldest surviving son.
Yeah, but it is interesting, though, that even though Dodd was not meant to inherit this empire, or whatever you want to call it, there was still that scene in a few episodes back with the open where Dodd is a child, and he takes Otto takes Dodd to the theater, and, you know... so there was still that moment, and that was a Dodd moment, not an Elrond moment. So, again, we don't know what Elrond was like at all and how they raised Elrond to be, you know, inherit the Gerhardt family, but...
Yeah, well, there's a little bit where Bear's saying, in like, one of the only family photos of all the
Gerhardt children,
Elrond's, you know, got his shirt making muscles. Everyone else is, like, wearing coats or something. Like, but so it's just... it's interesting. Even from a at that young age, you might get the idea that Dodd might have been raised to be muscle because Otto brought him there to do a killing.
Yeah, that's a good
exactly
point.
Not exactly to teach, you know, like values or
that's
or
a good point.
Like that. Maybe that's what's going on. In any case, Dodd, Hansi, well, basically Dodd's crew shows up. Bear goes inside. He hears that phone call, and the next we see of Bear, he's running out of the house, beating the shit out of Dodd, which is way overdue.
Yes.
And then Hansi pulls a gun on him, and Dodd's like, I can't have you, you know, beating me up in front of the men. I gotta punish you now. And that Bear agrees to that is just like this extra layer of, like, even though he hates it, Bear is going to do what's right for the family.
Exactly.
And in this moment, that's what he thinks is right, even if it's begrudgingly.
Yeah, just the emotional pendulum in this scene was unbelievable, because you have Bear beating up Dodd, and you're like, yeah, and then, like, all of a sudden you see Hansi, and you're like, oh, no, no, and then...
And then...
Floyd!
Yeah. You're gonna tear this family apart. Like, absolutely. Like... And good on Simone for fetching Floyd.
Yeah.
Like, you know, that was... She's like, all right, the only thing that's going to stop my uncle from getting beat up is if I go get Grandma.
Yeah. Floyd continues to be awesome.
Yes. The Gerhardt politics are so interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Because you just have so many different angles here. And, like, missing pieces, too.
Mm-hmm.
Because another thing I wonder is the difference in between the two of their wives, Bear and Dodd, because Bear's wife is gone.
Mm-hmm.
Honestly, if I had to bet, I bet Dodd married for love and... I bet Bear married for love and Dodd just married, like, a trophy wife.
Yeah.
So, yeah. Who knows? But in any case, Floyd then splits the brothers up. Both sending them, you know, she sends both of them to Laverne, but on different missions. Bear is to go get Charlie out of prison at any cost.
Mm-hmm.
And Dodd is to go kill that butcher.
Yes. Butcher of Laverne.
And so the two caravans roll out, and leaving the Gerhardt compound of, like, you know, none of Floyd's sons.
Yeah.
And which Simone becomes... called up Mike and was like, you know, this is your, you know, this is your chance. My father's going out to Laverne to kill this butcher. Go kill him. And Mike's like, you know, any last words for when I kill your father? Kiss my grits.
Yeah.
But the thing I wrote down here is, will Mike go to Laverne to kill the brothers or to Fargo to kill Floyd? Kill the muscle of the Gerhardt family or the leadership?
Oh, you wrote that down when you were watching it the first time?
Yeah.
Wow, look at you.
Well, the thing is, I wasn't planning on taking notes, but I got up from, to be honest, I was watching this entire episode while on a stationary bike. And I got up occasionally when I was like, holy shit, I need to write something down. And I wrote that down because I was just like, so there's something about, I'll explain, I guess the thing that set off my alarm bell was that Mike was not in a rush to like he seemed to like take in this information, and he just I didn't. The thing was, last week I had kind of predicted that Simone would lead them to Laverne on this chase. And a part of me was like, wait a second. I've never predicted anything on Fargo, right? I'm like, this is not going to happen. I mean, at that point, I didn't know, but my suspicion was that, you know, Simone phoned in and said, the brothers, you know, my uncle and my father are gone.
Yeah.
I'm like, fuck, wait, he's not gonna do that.
No, that was really observant. Good job.
Thank you. I guess the next thing we should go to is either of our two cops just talking to the Blomquist.
Well, hey, now we missed Jabberwocky.
Oh, yes, you need to explain the Jabberwocky.
Oh, well, to you, maybe not to people who are listening, but... no, I mean,
who's heard of the Jabberwocky?
I didn't mean that in an offensive way, I just meant... Oh, I'm sorry.
No, it's all right.
Well, because you specifically said last night that you'll have to educate me on the Jabberwocky. Or actually, you said Jabberwacky, which yes. Shows how much I need to educate you on the Jabberwocky. Which I can't believe you never... Because I'm pretty sure that I read it in, like, middle school. I feel like I read it in, like, 7th grade English. But, basically, it's a Lewis Carroll poem from Through the Looking Glass, which is the sequel to Alice's Adventures in Wonderland.
Okay.
And it's a really interesting poem because it's... most of it is made up words that just like they sound like they should be words, but they're made up. So like the first stanza was, 'twas brillig and the slithy toves did gyre and jimble in the wabe. All mimsy were the borogoves and the mome raths outgrabe. So it's like absolute nonsense, but like you can kind of figure out what it's supposed to mean. Exactly. And I'd not actually like, I hadn't read the poem in a very, very long time, but you know, hearing him recite it was just, like, so... It just sent a shiver down my spine. Like, beware the Jabberwock, my son. It becomes so... I mean, it is actually a really deceptively sinister poem. And because they're out hunting the Jabberwock. And the last... He doesn't read the last two stanzas, but the stanza he ends with was when the Jabberwock is killed. One, two, and through, the vorpal blade went snickersnack. He left it dead, and with its head, he went galumphing back. So, he just kills the Jabberwock, takes off its head, and went galumphing back. So, I mean, Mike has already taken off some people's heads before. And I just thought it was really, really, I don't know. It, actually, interestingly, I read somewhere, I don't remember, but Kiss My Grits was a line from the show Alice, like a 70s show Alice.
Okay.
And then Alice is maybe how Mike made the connection to Jabberwocky, because it's from Through the Looking Glass, which is the sequel to Alice's Adventures in Wonderland.
Yeah.
It's pretty interesting.
If I may throw in something here, because I say, listeners, if you don't want to hear about what happened in the preview for next episode, just skip forward, I'll say, 2 minutes.
Yeah, sure.
Because in the preview for next episode, Simone, in a conversation with Mike,
mm-hmm.
says, "You're supposed to kill my father, not the cripple," referring to Otto.
Yeah.
So this, you know, the fact that I took off the Jabberwock's head could be like, I'm attacking the head of this family, or
that's probably what it is. Yeah.
He was on a hunt, and like, you know, when the Gerhardts didn't give in the first time, he threatened Otto, and when they went to war, and now he's going to, like, finish it.
Yeah.
Like they cut off the head of Joe Bulo, and now he's going to go take on Otto.
I would agree with that.
Yeah. But otherwise, I don't want to talk too much about what happened in the previews, maybe until the end of the episode.
Yeah, that sounds good.
looks like I could have told the listeners just to skip
30 seconds.
But that's okay. Had no idea how long I was going on for. Oh, yeah. Okay, so now we've got the Jabberwock. Now we should get to Lou and Ed.
Yes.
In custody.
Well, the first comes, I think, for Hank and Peggy.
Okay. I found both very interesting.
And it was such a good scene for both of them.
One of the things I tried to decipher, because, you know, Peggy, playing dumb, or she's just lying. You know, she's just not telling the truth to Hank about the situation. And one of the things I tried to figure out was, like, how did Hank break through Peggy's barriers in ways that Lou didn't? Is it just that things have gotten worse since Lou tried to get them to confess? Or is something about Hank, like, is he telling it in more straight ways than Lou was? Like, they tried to kill your husband. Or him saying, like, oh, you're a little touched, aren't you?
I mean, I think that Lou and Hank are equally straight. I think that part of what was so successful for Hank was just that Peggy didn't have Ed to hide behind or manipulate. It was just Hank and Peggy.
Okay. Yeah. I mean, on a comedic level, I loved how Hank was on the verge of moving her magazines.
Mm.
And he's very polite about it. Mm-hmm. He puts them right back.
Yeah.
Man, there's just...
It was a great scene for Hank, though, especially because he hasn't had all that much to do recently.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, he... for the most part, he trades stories with... he trades stories with Lou.
Mm-hmm.
He ran into the mafia earlier on.
Yeah, well, last episode was him with... was that last episode or the one before that, where he's just in the house with Betsy?
I think it was just last episode.
Yeah, okay.
Like, small family moments for the most part. And this was kind of a time to shine for Hank
in some
ways. Especially since so many of us were concerned about Hank's life being on the line.
Yeah.
Not just once, but twice.
Yeah. Well, I got really worried. I didn't think that the porch was going to be his end, because they showed that in the preview. But although now we know the previews are giving away a little more than they usually do. But anyway.
Yeah, so one of the cruel things about that was that they didn't kill Hank on the porch. But we were still left with so much anxiety.
Because he's just there. And, well, because
when Dodd's crew shows up.
Of course.
And Lou gets... you know, Peggy to go into hiding, and we see Hansi sneaking around.
Mm-hmm.
I wrote that, you know, okay, Hansi mercies Hank, you know, bashing him in the head, knocking him out, so there's no death here. But we're still left with a tremendous amount of anxiety, because it's like, you hear Dodd say, I'll come back and clean up.
Yes.
Which, as far as we know, that could mean, killing Hank.
Mm-hmm.
We don't know.
I was also concerned, too, because when he finally wakes up, now we're jumping way ahead, but when he finally wakes up from the, you know, being knocked out, and he's on the phone with, I don't remember her name from...
Well, the
police station. Yeah.
He might try to make a hero move.
Exactly. Well, I was worried because I would think that, you know, as Lou's father-in-law, he'd probably be like, oh, God, I gotta keep Bessie's husband safe. And I was hoping, like, oh, don't go. Listen to Lou. Don't go. And he listened.
One of the things I was thinking was, I thought Hank's state of mind might be, I feel lucky to be alive right now. I'm gonna take this a little bit easy, or I'm just gonna hope.
Yeah. A lot of people were very concerned, or like they didn't get it that actually, I mean, the AV Club in their review of the episode, they devoted like several paragraphs to like not understanding why Hank didn't check up on Peggy, and part of me was just like, I mean, he was just like massively concussed, and all he heard was, you know, sheriff, he's sheriff, right?
Yeah,
there's Cher, and he picks up the phone, and so he goes, and he, again, massive concussion.
Call of Duty. Exactly. I want to jump back to Peg, because there's so much here.
Yes.
So back when Hank and Peggy are talking, Hank asks, like, I just got to ask, like, when you hit that Gerhardt fellow, like, why didn't you just take him to a hospital or wave down a motorist?
Yeah.
And she's like, you say it like it's an A or B choice, but it's just something like you do in a dream.
Yeah, and doesn't all just happen in a vacuum.
Mm-hmm. And one of the things I gotta, like, the way she phrased it, it's like a choice you make in a dream.
Yes.
That's really messed up. Because, like, if you ever have a dream where you do something super immoral and you wake up and you're like, well, I would never do that, right?
Mm.
It's just, there's something about that where I'm like, I could see how Peggy hits Rye and is like, I've got things to do. I have aspirations, and she's instead of thinking about it, she's like, I'm going home. I'm driving home right now. And like, we kind of see that, and she just continues her day as if that didn't happen.
Yeah. I think that, you know, and just that there's in so many, you know, times in life and just in shows, like I'm thinking right now, cause some of my friends are going through Breaking Bad for the first time, and they finally saw the first half of season 5 when like, I'm not going to say who. Okay. I'm just going to say someone gets killed like very impulsively, and the character's just like, oh my, immediately afterwards, the character's just like, oh my gosh, I didn't have to do that. I could have done this. And it's just like sometimes these reactions that we think are the most logical things are just the least logical things.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Let's see. Oh, okay, so. Oh, all right. Let's stay at the Blomquist house, because sometimes it's easier to keep track of things while we stay in a location instead of jumping around chronologically. So we already kind of talked about what happens, Hank's side of the story, as far as what happens with the Gerhardt crew.
Yeah.
One of the things I wrote down here was... when Dodd and his boys are going through the house, and at this point, Dodd has sent Hansi over to the police station because to verify Hank's claim that, you know, Ed's really not there. So they go into the basement, which is great, because I think someone on Reddit had said, so I relayed it yet last week, that basement was just a kill room waiting to happen. Like something shit was going to go down in there.
Yeah.
And the thing I wrote down on this note was, if Dodd is killed by a woman, that would just be so just, since he's talked so much shit about women this season.
Yep.
And it didn't quite happen, though. So basically, let's say there's Dodd and two goons.
Mm-hmm.
One of the goons... I don't know how he got knocked out. It appeared he got hit on the head with something, but I couldn't tell what it was.
Didn't someone say it was a sink? Like, he was hit with a sink?
It looked like a sink.
Yeah.
But I don't know how Peggy... Did Peggy drop the sink? Like...
I don't know.
Was she on top of the magazines and dropped the sink? Or did she just smash him in the head with a sink and decide not to do that 2 times in a row?
I don't know.
But it was, I wanted to say it was a sink, but I didn't want to say it on the podcast because it sounded so ridiculous to me.
No, I'm pretty sure it was a sink, but...
So, Dodd hears that one of his men got hurt, and so he's kind of spooked. So when the other goon walks down the stairs, Dodd just fucking shoots him. He's like, ah, shucks, or something like that. And... It really just tells you how little these farm boys mean to the Gerhardts. Yeah. So Dodd is walking around with his like cattle prod and his revolver.
Mm-hmm.
I believe at some point he puts the cattle prod down, Or Beth
he must have.
Because Peggy gets a hold of it
and
zaps him. And Dodd calls her a bitch. And then Peggy zaps him again until he, like, passes out.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just wonderful. And Peggy is not a killer. But a part of me was like, oh, are you gonna double tap him? Are you gonna take that gun and just end this? And we don't see that. So the thing that... I'm actually kind of glad Hank didn't wrap up the Peggy plot, because now Peggy is free to run to the LifeSpring seminar in Sioux Falls, which got name dropped for this episode, so it's almost certainly going to happen in the show now. So Peggy is free to run away since she has a car of her own, and now she's incapacitated Dodd. And who knows, there's every chance that towards the end of the episode, like, or let's just say, like, there's every chance that Peggy runs up with Ed and the two of them run to Sioux Falls, maybe. But I'm also now interested in what happens to Dodd, because if after this episode ends, let's say Hank and Lou go to the Blomquist house and pick up Dodd, then they've got two of the Gerhardts in jail.
Right? Mm-hmm. Yes.
So yeah, there's stuff in play here. But if you'd like, I think I'll say let's get to Simone and Floyd, and then we'll finish the episode from Lou's point of view.
Okay, so then we're gonna talk about Ed and Lou, and could we skipped over that? Okay, perfect. Yeah.
So, Floyd. Brings Simone over and kind of asks, like, if you're on the side of the family.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of making the point all too late that you're either in the family or you're not. You don't kind of get to choose both. And I don't know... Floyd doesn't know that she's been seeing someone from Kansas City. But
no.
Floyd maybe has picked up on, that Simone doesn't like her father.
Yes.
And wouldn't be upset if bad things happen to him, maybe.
Yeah, I think
that's not how the family goes. The family's got to protect the family. And a part of me was holding my breath because I'm like, during this whole talk, I'm like, this is the moment they're going to fucking open fire.
Oh, I just was not anticipating anything, so.
Well, I was just so nervous that while Floyd was giving this talk to Simone, like this inspirational, like this is a woman's world now, there ain't no job a woman can't do, and and these two characters I like a lot, and I was just waiting for the moment a bullet went through the window and like killed one of my favorite characters or both of them. So yeah, that happened, and suddenly Mike and the kitchen brother, and they're just pumping shotgun rounds and submachine guns all over the Gerhardt compound. And we mentioned earlier, some casualties, some guards get killed.
Yeah.
All in all, pretty dramatic ending, and I kind of can't wait to find out how Bear reacts to this, especially since Bear doesn't really come back, well, neither of the brothers come back with a mission success.
Yes, so it'll be interesting to see how, people on the Gerhardt compound react to what Dodd and Bear did, and what Bear and Dodd think about what happened at the Gerhardt compound.
Because it's a complete loss, and they kind of look like fools.
Yeah.
Because nobody, like the brothers didn't come home with what Floyd asked. And Floyd's got to be kicking herself, or not kicking herself. Floyd's got to be like wondering who the rat was.
Yeah.
Or saying, "Hey, look," like, or realizing like this was a bad call. Either she's going to take responsibility or call out a rat. What I have to wonder is, with so much power there, how, like, because this is a complete sneak attack, how do Mike and the kitchen the remaining kitchen brother and all those Kansas City guys, because that was like four cars worth. How do they not completely finish the family? Or is it just they're going to send a message by attacking? Like, I thought the time for sending messages was over, right?
Right. I don't know. We'll see.
I wouldn't mind getting a return to, like, return to the compound at the beginning of the episode. Mm-hmm. Like, if episode 7 was, like, Bear shows up and sees the carnage,
mm-hmm.
maybe there's a safe house in the Gerhardt family. Like, maybe some prominent Gerhardts just go into, like, a bunker and lock the door or something.
Yeah, I don't know. That
seems like something a compound should have.
Yeah, I'm thinking, though, that, because, I mean, the past episodes, it seems like it's pretty much been, you know, one full day is one episode, whereas this one happened in just a few, I guess,
hours,
and it was right after the last episode. So I'm thinking probably for next week, we're going to get the same thing.
Yeah, because this
is right after.
This is practically 4 hours, because as Madison Badger mentioned, the drive from Fargo to Laverne should be like a 3 hour drive. So this is like a 4 hour thing, if we assume that Dodd and Bear drove into town and wasted no time, right?
I think that's, yeah.
So yeah, let's talk Lou and Ed. Because,
last but not least.
Yeah, on Lou's part, I don't know how much I have to say besides he's not taking Ed's shit.
Yeah.
I think the more interesting thing is the way Ed is kind of slowly taking on like his darker qualities, because he's at this point where he's realized, like, family matters to me so much that I'm going to do whatever it takes to defend it,
or yeah,
defend what's mine. This is like, you know, like, basically admitting to Lou, like, they can keep coming, I'll keep, you know, defending myself.
Mm-hmm.
And Lou's trying to get him to realize that he's in over his head, to no avail. And something that kind of deepens this for me is that Peggy mentions the house they live in is Ed's childhood home.
Yeah, that was a really interesting revelation.
Because it's just like he's been so sedentary,
mm-hmm,
in this town. Like, I bet that working as a butcher is the only job he's ever had, basically.
Yeah, and I would guess that that's probably what he always wanted to do. Maybe it's what his father did.
Yeah, so it's just, yeah, kind of doubling, like, and we're seeing how dark that can make somebody, where,
mm-hmm,
he's like, I want my lawyer. Like, yeah, he's now entered into that phase. And also, ultimately, when he runs away from the, mm-hmm, lawn, he's really doubling down on this.
And I think not only is he maybe getting, like, as you're putting it, darker quality, I think he's also just, the burden is really, really weighing on him now. He's just, you know, like, he repeats the Noreen's story, which is the myth of Sisyphus, to, mm-hmm, Lou, and, you know, he is Sisyphus, basically, right now, or he feels like he is, just, although I'm sure Lou probably feels like he is, too, just every day, every hour is just the same thing, over and over and over again. Each day is just pushing that rock up the hill again, only to have it fall all the way back down.
I feel like Lou's actually making, even though it might not feel like him, we know Lou's making progress, like, every episode,
right,
it's coming closer to the end of this thing,
right?
I guess ultimately his retirement too.
Yeah.
I really liked that Ed was like, kind of going on about, like, he knew the story, but he didn't know the name of it. So it's yeah, kind of only up to the Fargo viewers who do any type of research into the episode names. Mm-hmm. I don't think the myth of Sisyphus is quite as well known as some other ones.
Yeah.
So, but yeah,
I will say that, in, although Carl Weathers, you know, bless him, and everything out of his mouth was pure gold. One of my favorite lines in this episode was when Ed just said, when Lou just says to Ed, just matter of fact, no BS, just there was a cleaver in the man's head, son. That's just like how you, whenever you deal with any idiot in life who's like trying to get out of something, you're just like, no, listen. Like,
I'm thinking about grabbing that audio clip and just throwing it in the beginning.
Yes.
If I could find it without a hassle,
that would be fabulous. That would make me so happy. Watch the whole episode again.
Oh yeah, that would suck, right? I can't believe I hadn't mentioned Carl Weathers until this point, because
We haven't talked about Carl yet. Were we gonna go to?
Because like Nick Offerman stole this episode.
I think I said at one point, I said to you, this is why Nick Offerman is on this show. Like, yeah. Out of the way, tool of the state.
they drafted this character, I bet, and they probably wrote this character for him. To cast him in it. And it's funny, so because Nick Offerman had mentioned that his character was a lawyer.
Right, and it hadn't been a thing until this episode.
And I didn't mind that I knew that information, because when Ed requested a lawyer, I started, like, clapping my hands. I'm like, yes!
I texted you, I said, OMG, is Carl going to be Ed's lawyer? And then I said, Carl, Fargo's Atticus Finch.
Yes. Carl being drunk was just this extra layer of incredible. Because it just made everything... like, this is the funniest moment of the season by far, because
I am slightly inebriated.
Well, because like he goes into the room with Ed and he's like, no, like, I don't want any, like, no oratory confirmations, just G or NG, and because they got cameras, a single nod, head shake for affirmative, nod yes for no. It's just like, God.
I also loved him when he pulls up the bench and he's like, the jackboots are upon us.
Yeah.
I think in a lot of ways, because I think
we're allies, like Ho Chi Minh and the Red Chinese.
Well, I think back when we did our podcast for the first episode, we were talking about like the different connections to the Coen Brothers movies, and I said, oh, like maybe Carl's supposed to be John Goodman from Big Lebowski, and I think he is supposed to be that now.
I feel like this is the peak for Carl, and especially the way they treat Carl in the credits of this episode. I feel like, I wouldn't be surprised if this is the last of we see of Carl until maybe like episode 10 or something like that. But like his plot moment has like come.
Yeah, I think we'll probably still check in, because he shows up in all these random places. So I don't think we're not going to see him, but I don't know that he'll be as much of a factor, which like I don't,
The reason you put Nick Offerman on the show is obvious this episode.
Yes, exactly.
Whereas before it's like, okay, it's kind of funny that he's here.
No, it's Nick Offerman, but now it's like, yes, this is why it's Nick Offerman.
Mm-hmm. So, and we'll get to it, but like, man, he does range.
Yeah. Oh my gosh.
Emotional range.
Do you think he gets nominated for an Emmy?
Oh man, if he stole a supporting actor from Game of Thrones, I would be for that. But who knows? He's doing more than drunk man. He's doing like drunk conspiracy theorist, super lawyer type shit.
One of my favorite quotes from Ron Swanson is, awards are stupid, but they'd be less stupid if they went to the right people.
Okay. plot wise, let's link here.
Onwards.
Okay, yeah, so Carl, you're right. So I mean, you mentioned it a few times, like Carl leaves. He comes head first with Bear and the Gerhards, and then he comes back in, barricades the door, the jackboots are paws. And then at that moment, there is a discussion between Lou and Bear about we call for backup. You're not going to get your son. Just walk away.
Right.
I mean, you know, Lou's just kind of standing his ground. But when he returns and his deputy locked the back door and she's made the call, and like the woman has made the calls. There was this moment when he told the deputy to like crush light bulbs and scatter them around so he could hear if people sneak. There's a moment I thought that like Lou was just going to use his Vietnam skills to like home alone his way out of like fighting the Gerhardts.
Yes.
Like oh no, like bear opened the door and a paint can hit him in the head, like just silly shit like that. I'm glad it didn't come to that. Because the diplomatic solution to this is really interesting. And something I texted to a friend was that there's other friends I talked to Fargo about. Ooh. Sorry.
Wow.
One of the things I wrote was like, one of the things I like about Fargo is you don't have to kill off characters or have a massive amount of violence to end a conflict.
Yes.
Like this conflict was ended with, first of all, Lou being clever and sending out like a diplomat to negotiate like some terms. So Lou gets Ed out of prison because Ed is the one at risk of being killed. And, you know, leave Charlie there because worst case scenario, nobody in the prison, nobody in the police station has to die defending Charlie. Mm-hmm. I'm sure Lou told them to like stand down if Carl couldn't get the job done. And there's no reason for Carl to die because he's not going to put up a fight. So this is all very clever. And the only one who catches on to all the sound that Hank and Ed are making is Hanzi.
Yeah.
And Hanzi even pretty far behind them in a way that is pretty lucky. Like Hanzi might have been on the other side of the station or something, mm-hmm. I guess. And of course, one of the things I like, I mean, like, so Carl Weathers is like on the verge of crying almost the entire time he's talking to these guys because he's got shotgun right in his face. But one of the things I really liked about Bear this episode, I should find out this actor's name because he does a really great job too.
Yeah, I don't know his name.
Because when Carl keeps repeating, like he's 17,
mm-hmm.
like he's a minor. This could be a minimum 5 years thing. And what you're doing right now is only going to make this worse for him. And he says it more than once, like he's 17, and Bear is just realizing like this is definitely not what I promised for Charlie. This is definitely not what like he and Catherine, I believe his wife's name is. It's not what they had planned for Charlie. Was like this. We got, you know, and if they break him out, like sure he doesn't want. He's angry that Dodd sent him to do an assassination, and he's upset that Charlie's in jail. But this point that this is not the best thing to do for Charlie rings with Ed. And if it were Dodd's son in there, like if Dodd had a son and his son was in jail, Dodd would not be so smart.
Somehow, I mean, whether he was, I mean, I guess a lot of it was just utter dumb luck, but you know, Carl was really appealing to the right emotions within Bear.
Yeah. I think I would. That's just the right angle to take, no matter what. Is just a. And he held the line when he's like, "All right, well, we'll leave Charlie, but take the butcher."
Mm-hmm.
Nope. Because then your son's also a part of, you know.
Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah. So it's really good, and you know, and Bear. Bear's like, all right, let's get out of here. And poor Carl just starts crying. Okay, can't forget that all the while Sonny is just in his van drinking a beer or something. Because one of the things I wrote down here, I was about to blank out on Sonny, except I wrote down, is Sonny going to get his revenge on Hanzi?
Mm-hmm.
Because I thought, all right, Hanzi's a badass, but what's one thing Hanzi can't kill with a knife or gun? Probably a van. Because the thing I was thinking was, all right, the entire Gerhardt force has no idea Sunny is just sitting there in a van. And it'd be pretty hard to get taken by a van, like, by surprise by a van.
Mm-hmm.
I admit that. But I thought, the fact is Sonny is just too cowardly, or too, he's not that type of man of action. Like, he threatened Hanzi in the garage, but he wasn't really prepared to do anything about it, I don't think. And I thought that there might be a chance that Sonny could get revenge, even though that's not in his character, because that just seemed like a TV type thing to do. But now that I think about it, if Sonny just drove over Tanzi, that would be a really anticlimactic way for things to go. And again, like, out of character. Lou takes Ed. They're basically running to the forest. They run into a cop car.
Yes.
And I'll tell you another crazy theory I had.
Yeah.
Because I thought it was kind of suspicious to me. I thought, like, why hasn't Hanzi caught up with them yet? And when they were running through the forest, I'm like, I bet Hanzi is like a second away from like putting a bullet through Ed's head.
Mm.
Like, I thought all these things. And when they ran into a cop car, I thought, what I wrote down here was, like, holy shit, did Hanzi steal a cop car? Because I was thinking, like, there's got to be cars, like, there's got to be empty police cars, like, at the station. Like, what if Hanzi, I mean, it's in hindsight, kind of silly. But I thought was, like, what if fucking Hanzi stole one? And, like, Lou and Ed were like, oh, thank God, here's a cop.
Well, I wasn't necessarily thinking it would be Hanzi, but I was thinking, like, oh, are they sure that that's Hank in that car?
Yeah. But because, in any case, like, that they run into Hank is a bit of luck. It's a bit of TV magic, but I don't have a problem with that. But it's so coincidental that there was doubts in my head that things were going to wrap up so nicely. And they don't, because Lou and Hank reunite, but Ed takes that moment to bolt off.
Yeah,
and they're not really too angry about it. They're like, "Hey, don't wear yourself out. Come on." They're just kind of disappointed. Which is kind of the funniest thing. Like, I bet Lou is, you know, legit furious. But the tone the two of them take is like, that boy, what is he doing? And then we kind of get a fake ending. Because we start cutting to credits, but then we get like bits and pieces of like a closing monologue from Carl.
Yeah,
just kind of talking about stuff that kind of just sounds tough. But I guess the funniest bit about it is it sounds very tough, and he's kind of being macho again after dealing with this very, because he's talking about like, oh, like, you know, when cavemen fought mastodons or something like that. But what he just did is very much the opposite of what he's talking about, right? He handled a violent situation with his mind, not with spears like a caveman. So his like his exterior character and his mind are like two very different things, if that makes sense. Oh my God, this episode. I have one bone to pick with Rhinoceros, though.
Yeah,
there's only four more episodes left.
I know.
what the hell, Fargo?
I know. Oh, and then ends with wow, just to think about this episode, it ends with Man of Constant Sorrow, from which is another song from Oh Brother Where Art Thou.
Oh.
Which is how the first episode ended with Didn't Leave Nobody with the Baby.
Mm-hmm. And, yeah, this is a fantastic episode. Definitely a lot more to chew on this episode. I'd really have to go back, because like, every episode's been good, but it leaves me wondering what makes this episode something that is so easy to talk about, and the other one was like really good in a way that was like kind of choppy to talk about. Like,
I don't know.
Is it the action?
I think so. I think it's just because there was such constant action, and there were some different pairings this week, and yeah, I think so. Because, I mean, last week was really awesome, too, but we didn't have as much to say about it.
Just fantastic episode.
Yeah, someone, and I think it was the subreddit, said like that was the most intense episode of television that they'd watched since Ozymandias, the Breaking Bad episode, and I was like...
Yeah. Okay. So you know what I looked up before starting was because I didn't catch any UFO stuff this episode.
No, neither did I.
And I'll go back and check since I only have to watch the first 5 minutes to verify this.
Mm-hmm.
But someone said that if you look at the sky while the Gerhardts are driving to Laverne,
uh-huh.
you'll see. Streaks of light go across the sky.
Okay.
That it might have been the case that happened while Mike was driving to Fargo.
Okay.
I'll check, but I can see that being a low key visual cue. That I missed because I was focusing on the cars. But I can also see that being like if I go back and watch it and I don't see it, I wouldn't, because like actually showing something like a UFO, I feel like is outside of the boundaries of what they've done, because everything has kind of been like mysterious in some ways,
mm-hmm.
And we haven't quite gotten just like look at that unknown object in the sky. Yeah, and before we wrap up, we do have some comments from Madison Badger.
Yay!
So, they wrote from about last week that it was funny that it called the remaining kitchen brother like more emotional. Mm. And I kind of stand by that because they never looked so angry before as that surviving one did at Simone. Mm. Madison Badger says, they're pretty non-reactionary, almost alien, like Spock. I don't think any of the humans in the show were secret aliens.
But no, but it's just funny.
I know what they mean. they also write, Charlie is now in police custody. Do you think the Gerhardts will kill him in jail if they can't get him freed? I don't think that would ever be on the table just because, like, there's no way... Bear would let that happen, though.
Yeah,
I don't know if I feel the same about Dodd. Dodd does have family values, though. I don't know if he could actually kill a Gerhardt.
Yeah,
though we'll find out. I wonder if Dodd ever learns what Simone did, will he want to kill or threaten to kill Simone? I don't see the show allowing Dodd to do that.
I don't think so either.
That's a step too far, but I wonder if Dodd has that in his character.
Yeah, I think so.
And the last comment, I think the magazines are a joke / a callback to the era. Pre-digital age. I believe it was common to save, keep, hoard printed material. Heck, it was the only way to retain the info.
No, that's such a good... Yeah, I mean, my mom saves sure? every magazine.
You betcha. but yeah... I mean, Peggy just straight up answers the question for
us.
Like, I'm living in a time capsule, basically, right?
Mm-hmm.
Or in a lost time.
Yeah, life. And she says that she's always... I mean, it's part of her job. The part of it is also just her own want to be, you know, be the best me she can be.
Mm-hmm. Oh, it's just so sweet.
I know. She breaks my heart.
Yeah, it's like, darling, the magazines aren't the way to do that.
No.
This LifeSpring thing isn't the way to do that. I think part of me feels like it's the intersection of the LifeSpring and the Sioux Falls massacre is looming ever closer.
Yeah.
Because I voiced the theory here before that the Sioux Falls massacre would be like, oh no, like all these women that maybe it's not all women, but like all these people at a life seminar, like a self-improvement seminar, like all got killed because of this misunderstanding between like Kansas City, and a part of me doesn't like. I don't see the show indulging in like showing us a mass shooting. Like, I feel like that is a little bit
over the edge.
I feel like there are other options. Like, there are other options. Like, you know. I'm trying to think about which characters I can see doing the Sioux Falls Massacre. I could see
Mike.
I could see Mike doing it. I could see Hanzi doing it. I don't see it being a Gerhardt.
No.
Like doing all this killing.
Agreed.
And Mike. So if we have Mike and Hanzi being like the two that could do it. For those two factions in a war, let's call it like a war based move. The other thing I can see is like one of the Blomquists doing something like that, not accidental, because a massacre is going to have to be very intentional, but it's like they do something that kills a lot of people and it's like, wow. But like afterwards they're like kind of in this state of shock where it's like, oops, and they just run away or something. Really, really something there. Because, I mean, they gave us so little in season one, which is great. Because it's leaving us hanging right now.
Yes. No, it's so good.
Yeah, very, very good episode. Rhinoceros is very good. It's starting to get me to think about, like, you know, I'm starting to think about the end of the season and what I would want out of the season three, but I think I'll save that question for the finale podcast.
Yeah.
One thing I'll say, because this episode kind of ends, like the closing shot is Hanzi following Ed's trail.
Yes.
And I'm thinking, like, I don't think I want anything bad to happen to Hanzi, even though he's put a gun on Bear. I just kind of have this arbitrary, like, Hanzi's badass, and is he just doing everything out of loyalty to the family or to Dodd, or, but I kind of want to see him survive, or if he goes out, then it has to be a comedy of errors, like, just the way that Ed has been killing people left and right so far.
Yeah.
It would have to be Ed doing something the same way.
Yeah.
Or Hanzi maybe underestimating Peggy or something like that. Who knows? I mean, because the thing is, like, just because Hanzi is on Dodd's side, I don't want to, like, oh, Hanzi, you gotta die because you're on Dodd's side. Dodd, I want bad things for Dodd, but... So much. I don't know. Before we wrap up, do you want to talk about anything in the previews, or just kind of leave episode 6 as is? Cause,
I think let's just leave it as it is.
Let's just leave it as it is. If you got fan mail, you can write a comment on YouTube. You can send email to seabrigadepodcast@gmail.com. I'm trying to think where else. I mean, if you're incapable of leaving a YouTube comment or sending an email, you're out of luck. those are the ways to contact us. And I know what you could do, because, you know, if you send us an email, you're afraid I'm going to read poorly, I'm going to screw up the point you're trying to make. We totally accept listener voicemail.
That's true. We did get some of those from Broadchurch.
Yeah. If you wanted to send in an audio recording explaining your reaction, and let's cap it off at, like, 2 minutes, stop, like, just, you know, quickly, like, how you felt about things, or if you have a question to ask us, that's totally one way to do it. So seabrigadepodcast@gmail.com.
yes,
that's the place for that stuff.
Woo.
And with that, I'm gonna call it an episode of the Seabrigade.
All right.
Bye, everyone.
Bye.